Thank you, Wendy. It's a pleasure to be here tonight, and I'm very thankful, which is a theme I'm going to be coming back to numerous times in my talk tonight, that so many of you showed up to find out what I had to say. This is quite an unusual experience for me because I typically lecture in this particular theater hall, and I'm usually looking out at the faces of 18 and 19 year olds who are buried in their laptop computer pretending every once in a while to pay attention to me. So the crowd tonight is quite different, more mature, in a good sort of way. And as Wendy said, I am very interested in the study of happiness, and I hopefully will share with you some insights about other people's research as well as my own research about how we might be able to strive for, pursue, and hopefully capture a little bit of happiness for our lives. So, do you want to be happy? I'm going to pose a question to you. In your life, would you like to be happier? Raise your hand if you would like to be happier. Okay. All right, thank you. All right, that was part of the audience participation. Most of you raised your hand. A few of you were a little reluctant on that. I'll come back to you a little bit later. Okay, so my talk tonight is about happiness. What is it? How do we seek it? What is it related to? What other insights we might be able to muster in our discussion of happiness? So I'm going to touch upon several myths of happiness. So one key belief that a lot of people hold is that money can buy happiness. Some of you believe that. I'm going to be talking about that. I'm also going to talk a little bit about people who struggle with holding on to happiness and striving for it. In fact, they feel uncomfortable with it. And some could say that they avoid it. All right, at this point, you may be thinking, I can't believe that they give professorial standing to somebody who claims to study stuff like this. Me either. but it's too late, Wendy. You've already got it. The reason why it is considered to be a reputable topic for us to talk about is we can now talk about the science of happiness. So I do research and teaching in the field of positive psychology, the study of what is right with people rather than what is wrong with people. Right? This means that I study many of these topics. This is a little bit busy. I'm going to help you focus a little bit. Positive psychology is right in the middle, and it's linked to many other topics. So, for example, things that I've studied are things like happiness and well-being. Obviously, I'm going to talk about happiness tonight. Eudaimonic approaches refers to the striving for the meaning in one's life as opposed to just pleasure. And I've published several papers on the meaning of life, which I really wanted to talk about, but happiness won out. I do a lot of research on positive emotions. Humor, odd story, back when I was an undergraduate, I volunteered to help a professor do a study on humor. And my job as a research assistant was to go out to area primary schools and sit down with children. They were about 8 to 10 years of age. And I would tell them jokes. and then I would code what their responses were to my jokes. Okay, this was this terrible jokes, awful jokes, but I learned to deliver them with some degree of elan, if you will. And so it turned out to be an interesting study. But yeah, we study things like humor. What else? Strengths and virtues. Been doing some work on that. Wisdom. Room, I think, is filled with wisdom. Resilience, temperance, which is related to emotion regulation. I could go on and on. I'll mention one last one, the psychology of time. So temporal perspectives are very important in terms of how you live your life. How much do you spend looking backwards at things that have happened in your life? How much do you spend in the moment, in the present? And this is what mindfulness meditation attempts to get people to do. And how much do you spend thinking about the future? Do you think about these time perspectives in a positive or negative way? Are you stronger on one as opposed to another? It's fascinating work in this area. Can't talk about it tonight. But anyway, there's a million things related to positive psychology, and I've studied probably half of them here. And it's immensely gratifying and stimulating. So why is positive psychology new? Throughout its history, psychology has historically been interested in mental illness. So I'm mentioning here Freud's focus on neurosis and psychosis at the very beginning of the birth of the field of psychology. And subsequently, a lot of psychology has been focused on diagnosing and treating individuals who are not doing well, who are suffering from mental illness or other forms of dysfunction. So historically, psychology has mostly focused on this group of people in the whole population of humans. All right? Clinical psychology is very valuable. Has made great contributions. Some of my best friends are clinical psychologists. But it has led to a bit of an imbalance in the field of psychology because there's an assumption by a lot of people, including psychologists, that this is all we should study. Increasingly, we're seeing an upsurge of interest in looking at the people at the higher end. It's labeled flourishing here, and that is the attempt by positive psychology to foster and enhance functioning in many different domains, cognitively, psychologically, behaviorally, emotionally, and so forth, to help people get to peak or optimal performance, and hopefully achieve great well-being and higher happiness. So, positive psychology is interested probably in these two groups right here, which is redressing this imbalance within psychology. Now, there are many books on happiness. Here are eight. I'm just throwing eight up here to give you a sampling. There are dozens. If you were to go searching for them, I don't think you would have trouble finding 30 or 40 bestsellers that have happiness in the title somewhere. I'll mention two in particular, the happiness hypothesis right here in the upper right is written by a psychologist, Jonathan Haidt. That's how he pronounced his name, Haidt, which is very unfortunate for somebody who's writing a book on happiness. But by all reports, people I know who know him says that he's a nice guy. And he's got a very insightful way of tracing the evolution of the interest by the human species of pursuing happiness. And he takes it back to the study of early religions and historical trends through time to talk about how people have sought happiness in different ways at different times and different cultures. I highly recommend that book. It's a little bit dense in places, but very insightful. The other one I'll endorse, I'm not getting any kickbacks, by the way. The other one is by Richard Layard, who was, I don't think he's currently a member of parliament in Britain, an economist who approached the topic of happiness from an economics point of view. And very, very insightful about how people value things in their lives And he made the point that increasingly governments need to recognize that happiness may be just as valuable, if not more valuable, than the accumulation of a gross domestic product. Very provocative. These other books are also quite interesting. You could spend a lot of time reading about happiness. I recommend you actually practice it more than we read about it. Just to prove that this is a real thing, maybe not too convincing, but I'll prove it anyway. There are meetings of people who call themselves positive psychologists. So this is a meeting I recently attended in Montreal in July. 1,300 people from all over the world came to Montreal to talk about positive psychology for 4 days. So it was very stimulating because you have people from lots of different areas, not just psychology, not just counseling psychology or clinical psychology, but you have other people who do professional development in professional organizations or businesses. A wide range of people. Fascinating to go to. Closer to home, there are two conferences I'm mentioning here. This one is called Happiness and Its Causes. So if you're interested in my topic tonight, you may be interested in this conference. It is given every year in June in Sydney, and it's been going on now for at least 7 years. So it's got a good track record behind it. I am part of the governing board or whatever of the New Zealand Association of Positive Psychology, so I gotta give them a plug as well. So this is our local group within New Zealand. We've been meeting in Auckland. Obviously you can recognize Auckland there. We're not meeting this year. I think we're actually gonna meet in Australia next year. But if you are interested in joining a local group on this topic, this would be the one I'd recommend. Okay, so let's get back to happiness. What is it? How can we define it? Well, different people will define happiness in different ways. I like this particular definition. It'll be one of the few things I actually read verbatim, so bear with me. Happiness is a mental or emotional state of well-being defined by positive or pleasant emotions ranging from contentment to intense joy. Now, I like this definition because it encompasses a lot. All right. So some people will say to me, well, contentment is not really happiness. You're a half step away from falling asleep. Why is that happiness? Joy, where you're jumping up and down, that's happiness. Well, the older I get, the more I realize that there are many shades of happiness. And I like to be able to include contentment and a degree of satisfaction in a definition of happiness. It is fundamentally based, however, in a positive or pleasant emotion. So there needs to be a positive affective glow about it. And most people are aware when they are happy. Not everybody, I might point out. Some people are not very good at recognizing their own emotions. We have a technical term for that. But most people are able to recognize when they're happy. And they're usually able to link it to some reason. So I give the example here. I'm happy that my family is doing well. So you'll say things like, I'm happy because I passed this exam. I'm happy because I proposed to somebody and she said yes. Things like that. Right? So it's frequently attached to people, situations, and objects. Sometimes you just have a free-floating happiness. You're just in a happy mood. And if somebody came up to you and say, why are you happy? You'd say, I'm not sure. I just feel happy. But most of the time, we can point to particular reasons why we're happy. We can enunciate them. We can think about them. And I put these pictures in here because everybody likes animals, right? humans are designed to smile and to be expressive of our positive emotions. So we have relatively easily recognizable signs of happiness, like smiling, raising our eyebrows, being welcoming, that sort of thing. It's been argued that mammals, other mammals, are able to express happiness. Their systems are not as sophisticated as ours. Humans have a wider range of expression of emotions from negative to positive compared to other animals. Okay, so most people want to increase their happiness. And let's tackle the notion that I enunciated before, what I refer to as a myth, the idea that money can buy happiness. All right, so everybody has heard this, of course. I'm not going to ask for a show of hands for people who believe this. And the reason is that probably everybody in this hall is aware of this point of view, and they're also aware of the countervailing point of view, enunciated very well here by Bob Marley. Maybe not an academic heavyweight, but somebody I admire nevertheless. So I'll let you read that. I'm not going to read it. I like his point of view about this. He's saying that you can, if you are searching for happiness through money, it may take you on a never-ending journey, and you will never get there. That's the gist of what he's saying. So I want to talk about the hedonic treadmill at this point, and I think it's useful in terms of explaining this contradiction. The contradiction being is that you may believe that, well, yeah, money can buy some happiness, and on the other hand, you believe, well, not all happiness is purchased. So what's going on here? The hedonic treadmill, some of you may have heard how this works, operates like this. All right, you're going through life and you decide to get a new and better thing or living condition. So it might be new clothes, a new car, you might remodel the kitchen, something like that. All right. So what happens? Usually, sometimes not always, but the case with remodeling, which can be quite painful and causing all kinds of unhappiness, but in a new car, new clothes, those sorts of things, you usually have a bump in happiness. So it results in an increase in happiness because you got what you wanted. It's lovely. It's wonderful. It looks pretty. It works well. I feel great. Right, so you get this elevation of happiness, but, and I highlighted that in red there, because this will inevitably happen, but you usually return to your previous level of happiness because of adaptation. Adaptation is this wonderful and terrible thing that humans do. We are immensely adaptable to new living conditions, changes in our lives, we adjust, we adapt, we change in accordance with it. So our neurological system, our behavioral system, our social system, our emotional system is constructed in such a way that we as humans get used to things pretty quickly. And you'd be amazed at the things you can get used to fairly quickly. So we can adjust to extreme conditions that may be somewhat unpleasant. Case in point is our third and youngest child has just started school at the University of Manitoba. He's grown up in Wellington where we've had snow, what, twice in about 20 years? He's starting to see snow and real severe cold. And that's going to be a shock to his system. And we know that. He knows that. We've talked about it and all that sort of thing. But you know what? He's going to get into it. He's going to adapt to it. You adapt to these things. That's an amazing capability that humans have. At the same time, it's also terrible, unfortunate, because we adapt to wonderful things in our environment as well. So if something positive happens, a new person comes into your life, your kitchen remodeling actually comes off under budget and on time, never happens. Let's say, hypothetically, I didn't say it does happen. You love it, but then you adapt to it. Okay, so we have this incredible human capability to adapt, and that hurts us, seemingly, in this case. So we adjust to this new thing, and then what happens? We want new toys to boost our happiness again, because we just got that wonderful feeling. I want it again. It becomes addictive. All right, so it's a treadmill that you find yourself on, running after more and more toys, getting them every once in a while, enjoying them for a little bit, seeing them fade, and then having to replenish and replace. So that's the treadmill. Here's another depiction of it, which I won't take through. My point on this slide is that it captures people because it's addictive. Humans are built, physiologically built, to respond to pleasure. I hope this is not news to you. It motivates our behavior. We seek pleasurable experiences, things like food. And I'm mentioning sex there as well. I'll be careful what I have to say about that. But those experiences for humans are highly motivating because we are built to have pleasure from eating tasty food and certain kinds of sensual experiences. Why? Well, from an evolutionary point of view, we want the species to be able to eat, to stay healthy, so that they can then reproduce. Right? So the motivation to seek these pleasurable experiences have been very, very effective in proliferating our human species, maybe a little too much so. So be aware that there is this cycle that you can get captured by because of the addictive qualities of getting that bump in happiness every once in a while. And we live in a supercharged environment now where the media is like on steroids, where you're exposed to pretty glittering things that are offered for sale. So in this capitalistic society, we see these ads promising us that we will be happy if we buy this product over and over and over again. And in fact, it sort of falls into the background. You don't notice it so much. But when you look at an ad, the underlying premise usually is, if you buy this thing, you will be happy. It will be pleasurable. You will have fun. And it's enticing. So there were more and more people have been lusting after these different objects, earning money hand over fist so that they can buy these things, so that they can experience these wonderful things, so that they can be happy. You see where it's headed? So it ultimately it can lead, I won't say it necessarily leads in every case to this, but it can lead to a sense of frustration. It can lead to a sense of alienation, of feeling like I was promised this sense of happiness if I did these things, if I bought these things. You know what? I don't feel that happy. It's not continuing to make me happy. And there's a little bit of resentment, I think, that builds up from the failure to deliver. So let's just pursue this a little bit further. If money buys you happiness, It would seem that increasing income should predict greater happiness. And here's a particular study that is tracing the increase in annual income in US dollars, these are US citizens, from 1957 to 2005, roughly about 50 years. And over this period of time, there's been increased productivity and the average buying power of an individual or a family has gone up pretty dramatically, right? That's the red line. This is a series of points of measurement of happiness. Shouldn't it be going up as well? It's not. It is flat. And if anything, it's actually slightly going down. This would suggest that increasing income and happiness are not that strongly linked. All right. Now, I'm not an economist, and I'm not pretending to be an economist. I actually know there's one in the crowd here tonight. He or she might be able to say something illuminating to us at this point, but I'm talking, not you, so. I'm gonna go on with my stuff. All right, so let's talk about lottery winners. So a lot of people, and I've been known to buy a lottery ticket too from time to time, buy a lottery ticket in the hopes that they can win a large sum of money and that that will confer, it will bring a sense of happiness to them, okay? Okay, most lottery winners are very happy initially. Then they find out that there were these things that they didn't even think about that come up as problems, all right? So people come out of the woodwork. Your family members you haven't seen in decades suddenly decide to come visit you. Your ex-boyfriend or ex-girlfriend, who you thought it was completely over with, they come back up. So people are asking for money that you didn't really anticipate. If you throw yourself into in experiencing great levels of physical pleasure, people report that after a while it seems to be empty. It seems to lose its punch. We were talking about that. It's called the hedonic treadmill. And they find out that having all these possessions doesn't really make them happier in the long run because of adaptation. Right? So I'm encouraging all of you not to buy lottery tickets, and I will. I think that trying to be happy through a large sum of money is something that we're obviously tantalized with. And a lot of us would like to have the chance, I think, to prove experts like me wrong on this. But let me show you this particular study, which I think is quite interesting. In this case, the study is comparing individuals who won the lottery, and they show a steep boost in happiness immediately after winning the lottery, and then at 6 months, it had diminished somewhat. They still, to be fair, they still were happier than when they started, okay? I actually know from other studies that if you keep following them, at about 12 months, they return to baseline. They return to where they started, more or less. In comparison, we have another group who engage in what's called gratitude journaling. And this is where you write down at the end of the day three things that you were grateful for that happened on that day. And I've been doing this for more than 7 years. I don't actually write them down, I just think them. I don't feel the need to actually put them down on a piece of paper. I just, at the end of the day, before I fall asleep, I think of at least three things that I'm happy about. Maybe a terrible day, dominated by something that's awful, but I still think of at least three things. And three things that I honestly, genuinely, authentically feel grateful for, okay? if you do it consistently, you start to learn a lot about yourself, I have to say. And it gives you a different orientation to the people around you and the way you think about life. So I highly recommend them. And look, they benefit from it. Not initially. So initially they don't see much of an increase in happiness. It slowly increases. By about 3 months, it's still going up. At 6 months, if you believe these data, and I do, they're actually happier than the lottery winners. So 6 months later. And if you continue to do it, as I have in my life, I think you continue to see support for a certain degree of gratefulness. Okay, so buy a lottery ticket or very cheaply do a gratitude journal. It will cost you less money to do a journal. All right, and this is a study performed, I'll show you the next slide here. This was a group of researchers at the University of Auckland, as well as some people from Victoria. Wendy would be quite happy to see that we're right up there with the best of them. Mark Wilson, who is one of my colleagues, was obviously one of the co-authors here. Andrew Robertson was a student who went through our program many years ago. Chris Sibley got his PhD here. So we have Victoria's fingerprints all over there. What Chris did was to get a large sample of New Zealand citizens to respond to a survey periodically, and this has now been going on for more than 5 years. It's a gigantic longitudinal study. And one of the questions that they wanted to look at in this study was, does household income bear any relationship to degree of happiness? And there's several curves going on here. I want you to focus on this one right here, happiness. And there it is right there. It's pretty flat. There's a bit of a downturn at low incomes. So what that tells you is that if you have only $10,000 of household income and you bumped it through whatever means possible, getting a job, robbing a bank, whatever, your happiness will go up significantly. However, if you're at the median is about 60,000, and you've got a bump of 20,000 up to 80, not much difference, pretty flat. And it becomes even flatter as you go up. All right, so does money buy you happiness? I think what you can conclude from this is, if you're at the low end, if you have little money, an increase of money will make you happier. Okay, so it does have an effect in terms of lifting you up out of difficult, stressful situations. Anybody who is surviving on this amount of money has a very, very tough life. All right? And increased income actually will concretely lead to a greater level of happiness. But if you're already at a higher level, getting another $20,000 or $50,000 is not going to have much impact. This is New Zealand, which is obviously relevant here. We tend to be a very egalitarian society compared to other countries. The U.S. is enormous income inequality, and the curves are going to be more dramatic there than here. But here, once you get above about the median, you're not going to see much of a change. Okay, so another interesting issue that we can talk about is, should you buy a material object or an experience? You may have heard about this. This is talked about sometimes in magazines and newspapers now. So a lot of people think that it's better to go out and buy something that's going to be permanent, durable. You know, it's an object. You can drive in your car. You can sit in your house. You can put it on the shelf. You can use it every day. It's there, and I will derive happiness from it every day. It's durable, as opposed to an experience. It's a one-off. You go on a holiday, you know, it might be a nice week, but then it's over. I'd rather have that permanent kind of object, right? A lot of people think that. So what does the research say? This is a study published in the Journal of Positive Psychology and reprinted in the Wall Street Journal. And they compared expectations about buying an object versus buying an experience with how it actually turned out. Beforehand, the forecast was that buying an object would be 4.4 satisfying on a 7-point scale. So it's sort of in the middle. Buying an experience, less so, 2.9, so much lower. So most people thought before the fact, before they bought anything, that buying an object seems like it's going to be more punch for the money. 4 weeks afterwards, notice that the forecast for buying the object was pretty close, 4.4, 4.7, pretty much right on. So if you thought that that vase that you were going to buy would give you a certain degree of happiness, sure enough it did. Right? But this holiday, it didn't really expect too much out of. Wow, it really delivered 5.4 on the scale of satisfaction and happiness. So what this points to is that people underestimate the impact of experiences as opposed to an object. And now we're going to shift gears a little bit here, talk about other determinants of happiness. And I want to ask the question, do you know what makes you happy? Do you personally know? Are you confident in yourself that you know what makes you happy? I spend a lot of time asking people this question. It's a little annoying, actually, sometimes, I think. But I want to know. I want to know if people have a good sense of what makes them happy. And a lot of people express some doubt about this. And here's a quote from Nathaniel Hawthorne. I'll let you read it. I'm not going to quote it to you. And he nicely, poetically expresses the idea that happiness is a bit of a delicate process. I mentioned this topic the other night at home, and my middle son just piped up and said, you know what, chasing happiness is a lot like chasing shadows, and which is the same idea, by the way. That's what Hawthorne is saying here. Hawthorne is slightly more poetically put it than my son. But it's essentially the same idea. Happiness sometimes seems ephemeral, hard to pin down, hard to concretely capture. And that leads to a certain degree of lack of confidence on our part that we can actually reliably achieve happiness. So I'm now going to start to lay out some other alternatives, ways that we can think about happiness. So I've already talked about gratitude. So a gratefulness journal, I would recommend. Secondly, if you give time, money, resources to other people, practice compassion. It returns tenfold in terms of a sense of gratification, satisfaction, and happiness. Mindfulness, I love to talk about mindfulness at some length. I chose not to talk about it because it's kind of a niche topic. I do a lot of research on mindfulness meditation. It's a very good way to clear your mind, be in the moment, and unclutter the way you think about the world. And then there's flow activities. So I strongly encourage people to engage in flow activities. Flow activities are where you're so engrossed in an activity, you lose all sense of time and context and anything around you. You just become completely enveloped by the activity. In my case, basketball. And here's a picture, not of me. This is James Naismith, who invented the game of basketball, and we owe him a great debt of gratitude as far as I'm concerned. Basketball is an immensely engrossing activity that is quite challenging and demanding and is immensely rewarding if you invest yourself in it. But you have your own kind of flow, I'm sure, whether it's knitting, whether it's painting, whether it's playing a musical instrument, doing athletics of some sort, tramping. We all have something like this, and that sense of flow can be really a good boost for happiness. And I'm now going to talk about savoring. So we often don't know what will make us happy, and we vacillate in our happiness around what is known as the set point. Genetically, we seem to have a certain kind of anchor to a range of happiness emotions. So there's a range that we mostly stay between. All right, so you probably have friends who are constitutionally kind of down, and you've got to cheer them up a little bit. They're kind of morose, and you kind of expect them to be a little bit on below average when you meet them. And then there are other people who are just bubbly and happy, and they have a higher set point. Right? This seems to be determined to some extent by genetics, which is this blue part right here. About 10% by what actually occurs in your context, what happens to you. Do you win the lottery, or do you win a car accident? You ask somebody to marry you and they turn you down, and that kind of thing. So what happens to you makes a difference. This yellow part is what you choose to do to deal with your circumstances. All right, so that's the part I want to speak to. And I'm going to briefly tell you about one of my savoring studies. We got a sample of 483 community adults who responded to a survey link that was put in a Dom Post article on happiness about 5 years ago. And the question was, does savoring boost happiness? And I realize you don't know quite what savoring is yet, but I'll get to that in a minute. Before we get to savoring, I just want to report a couple of basic findings about happiness, because this is a lecture about happiness. First of all, I want to compare men and women. So you get to vote. This is the second audience participation. You get to vote for who do you think is happier, women or men? So people who think men are happier, raise your hands. Okay, these are mostly men, by the way. Women, how many people think women? Okay, there seems to be a majority of people. Some men there as well. All right, secondly, who do you think is happier? Young adults, so these are teenagers and early adults, like up to about age 25, middle-aged adults, 25 to 50, or I'm going to call us older adults, 50 and older. You don't get to vote on that one. So here's the result for the gender difference, and the majority was correct. Women are happier on average. These are mostly Wellingtonian people who responded to this survey. Maybe even some of you responded to this survey, I don't know. Women report that they are happier, which is great. Now, what about age? This is really interesting. A lot of people assume that young people are the happiest. They are, after all, afflicted with this youth thing where all their body parts seem to work when they get up in the morning. They don't have anything. So why are they unhappy? Well, it turns out that young people are kind of medium unhappy, and then when they get a little older, they get unhappier. I don't know how many 30 to 39 year olds we have here, not too many, because they're probably at home with their kids, or they're working overtime trying to bring in some money. So the 30 to 39 year olds are the unhappiest because they have a lot of pressures, a lot of demands on them, and my heart goes out to those absent people. Then life gets better. Kids grow up, you get more established in life, and as you get older, you get happier, which is cool. So if you are a 30 to 39 year old, it gets better. All right, so what is savoring? Savoring, according to Fred Bryant, who's the main theorist and researcher in this area, is that it's a set of strategies that you use to try to maximize the positive aspects of an event. That seems a little vague. But what it is a grab bag of different strategies that people use to try to emphasize the good stuff, as I call it, in the events that you have. And here are some examples. Sharing with others. So if you're going to have a professorial lecture, invite some people along to come here. Memory building. So take mental photographs of a particular time and place that you experience bliss and hold that in your mind forever. I've done that with my wife, and it's really helpful. Behavioral expression, you just let it out. You express how you feel. Counting blessings. I've talked about gratitude. This is what it's talking about there. Then there are things like killjoy. And it's an item like, I told myself why I didn't deserve this good thing. That doesn't sound like savoring, does it? Now, according to Fred, who's a friend of mine, we argue about this, he considers that an aspect of savoring. And he says it's a type of savoring. And I said, well, it's not a helpful type of savoring. And he said, yeah, admittedly, but it's a type of savoring. So if you do the psychometric work on this, which I'm not going to bore you with, you come up with two basic things. Amplifying savoring, where you're really maximizing the pleasure, and dampening savoring, where you're trying to minimize, believe it or not, you're trying to minimize the happiness or the pleasure. So I focused on the future on a time when this good event would be over. That's kind of a downer. All right, so dampening savoring refers to kind of avoiding happiness. So I predicted in this data set that amplifying savoring would positively predict happiness and life satisfaction, and dampening would negatively predict. And quite quickly, this is a path model for the maybe two people in the group who are interested in statistics. These are like correlations. There's two positive associations for amplifying savoring, and there's two negative associations for dampening savoring. So it turned out the way I expected. Not too surprising. All right, so the message here is an embrace and enjoy life. Savoring is more than just having a lovely cup of coffee. You can appreciate your accomplishments. You can anticipate good things that are coming in the future. You can remember good times. You clicked on the wrong thing. That's the trouble with having embedded URLs in. Get back on track. Okay, I'm just going to go on like this. Because I'm aware that my time is running out and I want to get through all the slides. All right, so why do people do dampening? These are the efforts to avoid and to kind of hold at arm's length positive things. If we return to the beginning of my lecture, I asked you to raise your hand if you wanted to be happier in your life. There are a few people, believe it or not, who just don't want to be happier. And they find it uncomfortable to be happy. And it's kind of unfamiliar to them, and it makes them anxious. So the way I put it is that a few people have a complicated relationship with happiness. And I have done a lot of research recently on the fear of happiness. If you want to come up with a fancy label for this, you can find it. Cherophobia is the technical term referring to avoidance of happiness. And related to that is the term anhedonia, which is a psychiatric term which refers to lacking in happiness or an inability to experience and feel pleasure, which is a symptom of major depressive symptoms. So it seems to be a clinical feature, and I wanted to ask the question, would we find fear of happiness in a community sample? So I got some data from undergraduate research methods students in Psych 232, of course, which I teach in this class. Now, you may argue about whether they're normal or not. These are psychology undergraduates, but they're pretty normal. And I gave them this fear of happiness scale. Here's some items. I prefer not to be too joyful because usually joy is followed by sadness. So there's a sense that I don't want to be too happy because it will evaporate. And I can't hold on to it, and I'll feel worse because I felt the joy and then I lost it. Right? So there's a sense of loss going on there. And this comes from work by Mohsen Joshanlu, who's a former PhD student at Victoria. He's gone on to do great things. Here are the frequencies of people responding to this fear of happiness scale within Psych 232. And my point is that about 15% of the class scored at or above the mean. That's not a large number, and I didn't expect that it would be. But these are relatively normal individuals. 15% are reporting relatively high levels of wanting to avoid happiness. And the fear of happiness was correlated in the way that I would expect it to be with a range of variables, including happiness. So people who fear happiness or want to avoid happiness are actually not very happy. Right? So that negative correlation there indicates that if you're high on fear of happiness, you're less happy. Makes sense. Then I wanted to look at whether fear of happiness would be a predictor of depression, or whether depression would be a predictor of fear of happiness. So I did a longitudinal study. I had to get that in there because I'm a developmental psychologist. And here is the result from that study. The important thing is that fear of happiness was a significant positive predictor of depression over time, whereas depression did not increase or decrease fear of happiness. This means is that fear of happiness is a risk factor for the development of depression. So if you have a friend who you invite to a party and they say, it sounds like too much fun for me, I'd rather sit home and mope. Okay, you might be a little worried about them. And then here is a longitudinal result over time showing that fear of happiness leads to a reduction in hope, which then in turn leads to higher depression. So fear of happiness seems to have an effect on depression through diminishing hope. Hope is a very important positive emotion that motivates us to engage with life. And if we're missing that, then we're more likely to be depressed. Okay, so what have we learned on the road to happiness here? Trying to sum up. First of all, it's important to realize that it's difficult to increase happiness in a sustainable way. Right? And what I mean by that is, you can get a little bump here and there, it's very hard to get your happiness to a higher level and have it be maintained over time. That's what I mean by sustainable. All right, so you need to have the practice of something that you do constantly to keep it elevated. It needs to become a habit. You can't just do one thing and then be happier forever. Right? So five issues I'm going to mention here. Money and material objects tend to lose their positive impact over time, so be suspicious of them, if you will. Be a little careful about how much you invest your emotions in that new thing bringing you a sense of happiness. Secondly, positive experiences. I talked about experiences being a good thing. And secondly, meaning-oriented activities, such as giving to people, do tend to yield more durable and sustainable happiness over time. In my job, I'm very lucky to work with students where I get to teach them, and that's one of those meaning-oriented activities which I benefit from. Thirdly, feel gratitude. Feel gratitude about just about anything in your life. You will find things to be newly grateful for once you start looking at your life. A lot of stuff we take for granted. But if you start enumerating at the end of each day things that happened that were helpful to you, you'll start to discover things in the background that are actually very instrumental for you. Number four, savor your positive experiences. My family gets tired of me talking about savor your food. Savor your experience. But it's really, it's a mantra for me. Don't just take life for granted. Take the moment to immerse yourself in it and enjoy it. And then lastly, don't let negative thoughts sabotage your happiness. So be aware of dampening thoughts like, I don't deserve this, or happiness is too fleeting, so I don't want to experience it, things like that. When you have happiness, embrace it. So we're at the end of my talk, and I have to bring in Dr. Seuss because he's one of the greatest thinkers of the 20th century. And he had a great message for living life in the moment. So don't cry because something is over, smile because it actually happened. And I want to end, of course, with a sense of gratitude. So I want to express gratitude to my family, to my wife and my three kids. Of course, they're now young men. I'm very grateful to my students and colleagues. I've learned so much from them. By teaching them things, I've learned so much in return. Thank you to the university. The university has been supportive of my efforts. They actually gave me a professorial role on the basis of this kind of stuff. Thank you to basketball because it's been a continuing joy in my life. And here's a picture of me really playing basketball. Good form. And lastly, to everybody who's had an influence on me, and I deeply feel a sense of gratitude to all of you. So thank you.